I'm State Representative Rosemary Brown, and welcome to the Legislative Report. I am joined today with Ken Thiel from District 4 PennDOT of Pike County. He is the county manager for PennDOT, and he's quite a busy man these days, right, Ken?
Yes, we are, Rosemary. It's our time of the year.
It is, and I really don't think that PennDOT ever has a time of the year that's not their time of the year.
No, they don't. They don't. It's a 12 months of the year. If it's not prepping for winter, it's fixing from winter all summer long, getting ready for next winter. So, right. Yeah.
Well, and I, one of the reasons I like to do this report with both Pike County and the PennDOT directors is really just to give people an idea of what's happening. Sometimes they know some pieces of it, or they hear pieces of it on the street, see blips and blurbs, but they really don't have the full information. So it's quick. It only gives you about 15 minutes. It's very hard to do that in 15 minutes. But for Pike County, we're going to try to just give a little bit of a recap and a little bit of some of the struggles and the issues that you're under, and some of the road work that is planned. And things can be altered sometimes when there's something that comes up that can then throw the schedule a little bit. But we're going to do our best to try to give as accurate as a profile as we can.
That's fine. That works.
So where would you like to start? I know that we had a rough winter season, and we talk about Pennsylvania roads, you know, with the heat and the cold and the heat and the cold. You always have that spoon analogy that we talk about.
Yes.
It's like breaking a spoon in half.
Yep.
Where do you go from there after such a tough winter and with the damage on the road systems?
Well, it was a rough winter. There's no two ways about it. It was not the coldest winter on record. It was not the snowiest winter on record. But it certainly was a rough winter compared to what we've normally had. Unfortunately, I think, Rosemary, this type of a rough winter, with the condition of the roads going into the winter the way they were, I think we saw what the effect of a bad winter can have on the highway system. And it definitely took its toll this winter. It did start early. We certainly had winter in December. And it went straight through until almost the end of March. And when I got up this morning, it was only 30 degrees. I didn't know if we were going to have to put the plows back on this morning or not.
You forget what month it is. Right.
We forget. So the seasons are running one into the other. There was a lot of freeze-thaw cycles this winter. The thing that I've seen probably more than anything else is the people don't allow the weather or the time of year to change their plans, and contractors are working year-round now. A lot of heavy equipment on the roads in a time of the year when that usually didn't happen. So between the freeze and the thaw cycles, as you mentioned, the roads did take a beating with the spoon effect. We're out there now. We're trying to see where we had sub-base, where we need to do sub-base repair. Our interstate highway took a really hard beating this winter. Anytime there's water involved with a road system, you're going to have issues. And of course, we in PennDOT, we make our own water in the wintertime because we melt snow. Even if we use pure salt, we're just making additional water. And eventually when that gets diluted, it turns to regular water, gets down in the cracks of the road, it freezes, it breaks the roads up. There's pockets of water underneath the road. When they freeze, water expands and creates a solid mass under, but it pushes the road up. And when you get in your potholes in the spring of the year, what ends up happening is when that water certainly melts, goes down into the ground, and there's a void in the road between the subsurface and the pavement. And as the cars drive over it, they push the pavement down, and you end up with your potholes. So we have a lot of subterranean water issues right now that we're looking at, and it did create a lot of problems for the roads.
And we know that you really can't, with these pothole situation, you're just beginning to really start to fill them, and it has to be 45 degrees and warmer to begin to even start that part of the maintenance, correct?
Well, one of the things that in certainly in Northeast Pennsylvania, one of the issues that we have is there are blacktop plants close. And they will close around Thanksgiving, and they will close until the middle of April. So we can't actually get hot mixed blacktop until a month ago. Mm-hmm. So that kind of puts us behind the eight ball a little bit. If the weather was nice, and we could have got out there in March and used some hot material. That's the permanent repair to potholes. We use cold patch. It does fill the hole in, but it doesn't last, and it kicks back out. So we were waiting for the blacktop plants to open up.
For the more permanent
fixes. Okay. So we're into that right now. Interstate 84 took a beating this year. There's a lot of potholes out there. That is our primary road, and I have two of my three crews. Two-thirds of the employees in Pike County are actually working on a mill and fill operation out on Interstate 84. Interstate 84 is a little more than 10% of my road network. I have 329 linear miles of road in Pike County. Interstate 84 is 35 miles of that. So it's a little over 10%. Right now, I have 66% of my employees working on 10% of my roads.
Yeah.
So 90% of my roads only have 33% of the employees able to get to them. So that's why there's such a backlog. Mm-hmm. But as we get one fixed, then we can move the people into other areas. And we're working Saturdays. We're working overtime trying to fix the potholes. And it was a tough season for us.
It is. And that's an interesting percentage, you know, of the workers and the interstate, because it is the major road. So it's really a priority roadway as you compare to secondary roadways. Well, where do you go from on the other major roadways? You know, I would say 739, 01, Silver Lake, you know, some of these other roads, you know, that maybe you can give us a little updates on.
Yeah, there's what they refer to as the business plan network. And there's a BPN-1, a BPN-2, BPN-3s, BPN-4s. A BPN-4 is a road that has less than 2,000 cars a day. It's based on the ADTs, the average daily traffic counts. BPN-4s are 2,000 and under. BPN-3 is 2,000 and over. And then the BPN-1s and 2s, that's part of the national highway system, which would be your interstates and your expressways and your interstate lookalikes. Interstates are BPN-1. Interstate lookalikes are a BPN-2. Most of the roads in Pike County are BPN-4 roads, but the BPN-3s, the ones that do have over 2,000, we do look at the traffic counts, and they're the roads that we're targeting right now with the new funding of the Act 89. That's kind of how PennDOT prioritizes their roads. We look at what number in that BPN system they're coming into. The BPN-3s are the 507. They're basically three-digit roads, 739. 402, mm-hmm. 507, 434, 590. They're BPN-3s and 4 roads that we're looking to focus our attention on now. With that new funding, you're going to see a lot of pavement in Pike County, a lot of pavement this summer. So we're hoping it's going to make a difference.
Good. I think there's a lot of people, you know, that call my office as well as call that PennDOT, and they, you know, they want to know what the status is and where we're going and what roads are in what order of getting fixed. The other road that's always, you know, especially in my part of Pike County, which is the, you know, Porter Township, Lehman, and Delaware Township is my responsibility as a state representative.
Yes.
The State Route 2001 project,
yes.
Which is a long-term project, several different phases.
Yes.
And we've run into a little bit of an environmental issue, which I think that the thing that people should know about is that we need to do it the right way so that we don't have the repercussions that were done in another part of the state by Penn State. That it happened and everything had to be reworked and more
Correct.
Money was spent. So give us an update on what you do know, because I know it's still evolving and there are still some
yeah.
moving pieces to it.
Yeah, and it's my understanding that you were involved with a meeting with Mr. Roberts and some of the other people from the Conservation District and DEP and the 2001 project was discussed. From what I know about it, internally in some of the rocks and in within the ground, there is what is referred to as acid rock. Pyrite, I believe, is the technical name for it. And it's not an environmental issue as long as it's encased or sealed in the ground. It doesn't create a problem. But if that gets exposed to the air and the water, you get an environmental issue. And I'm sure a lot of people have seen it. It's like an orange slime almost. It's iron. It's liquid iron is what it is. And if it gets into the streams and stuff, it does have environmental problems associated with it. So what they're trying to do is they discovered some of this acid rock in the design, when they were doing the design and the work for the 01 project, they found some pockets of this. And what they've done is there is ways of neutralizing the acid rock. They're looking at that, how they're going to neutralize it. They're looking at, they've come up with plans that I believe, from what I was just recently told, the Conservation District and DEP are very pleased with the remedies that PennDOT have come up with to resolve this issue so that the 01 project can go forth. It's not going to go forth this year, but it will be going forth probably next year. They're going back to that 01 project. The 01 project is on our TIP program, the Transportation Improvement Plan. The money that would have been spent on 2001 this year is actually being taken and applied to paving 402, which is in your area. Mm-hmm. And it's from the Monroe County line all the way up to Route 6 up in Blooming Grove. So we have that. The funding, the Act 89 funding, is going to be used to pave part of 507. We have additional paving. There's a capital side of our budget, which is another $1.8 million, and we're going to be looking to pave 434, 590. So I think you're going to see a lot of paving in Pike County, and we're happy about that.
Good, good. And and I think that's where some of the confusion with the 01 project, that, you know, because the project's not moving this year, that, you know, it was defunded, so to speak, in some ways.
Yes.
And it's just kind of a movement of funds for the usage or the immediate usage.
Correct.
And then that moving forward again next year is ready to go. But while we're working out the environmental issues, it
yes.
is still on the program and is still in its phases to move forward.
Absolutely.
So
absolutely.
I think
you'll see it back on
for
next year. And I hope that'll make the other people really happy with it. So.
Right. And in the meantime, I think that you and I are having very strong conversations about the maintenance of 01 and to do the best we can to make it as safe as possible with the maintenance.
We are, Rosemary. I just came back from a MEDP, which is a maintenance efficiency meeting that we had down in Harrisburg. And there was a lot of discussion about counties that are underfunded, counties that are either what are referred to as distressed or broke counties. And they're looking at the financial, what are these counties financially able to do? And Pike County at this point in time is basically considered a distressed county. We don't have enough funding to do what we need to do, but we're not a broke county. There are counties that are broke. And what that means is they're actually paying more for their employees than they're actually paying to do the maintenance. So
I think that's and as we close out, I told you 15 minutes went very fast, but I think that's another important point for people to realize, that the amount of road systems in Pike County, it's huge, and some of it's just tough to get all of that work done on the funds with the employees that you do have. But we're doing our best, and if constituents do have any sort of need or there's a problem that we should be aware of, both you and I with the road systems, absolutely call my office or to call PennDOT, and we will do our best to get you the right answer as well.
And as I told you, I think the last time I was here, it was 800. There's 810 snow lane miles in Pike County to plow. It's 200 miles to State College, to Penn State. You can drive back and forth to Penn State, back and forth twice, four times. To get that 800 miles.
Yeah, that's what happens when you live in a beautiful area with the rural nature. Yes. It's wonderful, but you do have these road systems that are spread out. So, well, Ken, we thank you for all your hard work. And if there's any questions for the Pike County road work, they can, like I said, call my office
or
PennDOT as well.
Absolutely.
So thank you again,
Ken,
for joining us again.
Thank you
very
much.
We'll be right back with the legislative report.
Did you know that the main entrance to the Pennsylvania State Capitol building is home of two bronze doors that each weigh over 1 ton? As the primary entrance to this beautiful architectural building, the bronze doors signify the many accomplishments and sacrifices endured throughout the history of the Commonwealth. The magnificent archway over top the doors contains a portrait of William Penn, founder of the Keystone State. The upper panels on the doors commemorate the forming of our nation with the signing of the Declaration of Independence and Constitution. The bottom panels depict the laborious industries of the Commonwealth, including coal mining and agriculture. Now you know.
Welcome back to the Legislative Report. I have Ron Young now with me from District 5 PennDOT, which is the Monroe section of PennDOT. And Ron, thank you for coming today to give us a little bit of an update on some of the road work and some of the projects in Monroe County with PennDOT. And earlier with Ken Thiel from Pike County, I mentioned it's hard to get everything in 15 minutes and yes. even in any detail. But this is just a little bit of a recap for people watching because they do get little pieces of information and maybe not always the right information. We're just trying to give them a little bit more of an updated piece for 2014 for PennDOT and what's on the plate a little bit for Monroe County.
Well, this year we're going to continue the work on the 611 bridge over Pocono Creek. Mm-hmm. That's going to shift into the next phase at some point early to midsummer, and that will include a partial detour. Unfortunately, they can't keep all lanes open, so the northbound traffic on that will be detoured for starting sometime this summer, probably for the better part of a year or so. Mm-hmm. So that's
always a little tough. Yeah. And when you do detour, most of the time you have to use a state road to detour, unless the township
is willing.
We try to.
I believe legally we can detour on local roads. We try not to do that because of the impact it would have, and a lot of local roads may not be able to handle it. And indirectly, many local roads become a secondary detour anyway, not to post a detour. So we do understand that. We try to minimize that whenever we can. Just some cases where you can't keep all the lanes open, or sometimes you can't even keep the bridge open, period.
Right.
Whereas we up on 447 right now, we have that situation, replacing that bridge. So that bridge will wrap up this year, and same with the 611, and we hope to get them both done by the end of this year.
And as you're quickly talking about bridges, I think it's important to note that, you know, the structurally deficient bridges in Pennsylvania, that we do seem to kind of be taking over with that structurally deficient classification on a lot of them. But the cost of the average cost of replacing most bridges, I mean, it's pretty high for one small bridge.
It's probably,
I think I know the number, but I'm going to let you say
roughly $1 million per bridge.
At least.
For smaller ones, yeah. Bigger ones, of course, it's much more. Finished up not too long ago the 7th Street Bridge. That was a multi-million dollar bridge, so bridges are expensive for a number of reasons. One, they usually require more extensive design work. They require usually some right-of-way acquisition. They require different type of work. Whether if you're working in a stream, you got to get through permitting issues, environmental issues, etc. So it's much more intensive
and we have a lot of bridges in Monroe County because of the amount of streams and the waterways.
Yeah, Pennsylvania as a whole, especially Monroe County, you have a lot of. And you have a lot of high-quality waterways up in Monroe County. Thankfully, it's good for the fishermen, et cetera. And because of that, you have to do extra special things. There's certain times of year we can't even be working near the water because of that fact. And Pennsylvania as a whole has 40,000 miles of waterways, which is, I believe, either the number one for the contiguous United States or maybe number two, but it's up there. And
yeah, I thought I'd bring that up.
All the roads have to traverse those waterways.
At one point and saying, and it's important because when you look at the dollars, being used to get these bridges back up to a standard of safety, on a very small bridge being $1 million and you have tons of bridges everywhere that need that kind of work, if not more than that, $1 million, that's a small amount when you consider.
The bad news is we're one of the leaders in structurally deficient bridges in the country. The good news is we hope within the next 3 to 5 years not to be one of the leaders. We're slowly getting that list down and replacing or rehabbing these bridges as a result.
Do you know anything about these precasting bridges that are happening too? That's a slightly new concept.
That came out of the P3 public-private partnership legislation that was passed last year and signed by the governor. Mm-hmm. What they're doing there, they're working through that process. We have accepted proposals, and there's another round coming up where they've narrowed it down to 4 teams to do between roughly 500 and 650 bridges all in one package to reduce the cost. They would be similar size bridges statewide, Right now, they're, if you've followed our travel advisories through our website or receive them like your staff does, you've been noticing there's been a lot of what we call subsurface drilling to get data for these bridges to provide to these teams so they can include that in their design work so they know what's going on underground, what they need to do to shore up a new bridge. They're similar sizes, so they can maybe precast a lot of them or order, if they're the same size beams, order the beams and get through a larger purchasing power, get that price down, similar to like a Walmart concept. Walmart's able to buy a million pieces of something at a lower rate than the local shop is if they're only buying 100 pieces of it. So it's similar type
mentality.
It's
a great way to save money, and it's a great way to get a large quantity of things done in one shot. It's being a good steward of the taxpayer.
Yeah, and we hope by the end of this year to have the team chosen. Stay tuned for that, and you can follow that. We do have a P3 section on our website where you can learn all about that process. There's a P3 board, statewide board, that oversees and manages
that. Since you mentioned
that.
The website, why don't you give us the website address just
it's,
in case?
If you just go on Google, search PennDOT, you'll find it, but it's dot.state.pa.us.
Great. So I took you off a little bit on the bridge conversation, but I thought that was an important point to mention. Some of the roadways, Route 80 obviously is on the conversation here for an upgrade completely, but in the midst there are some bridge decking and repairs happening. And then if you can take me into a little bit of some of the local roadways and what's happening with them as well as far as maintenance or repaving, as much as you know.
We're currently, this month, paving Business 209, pretty much between Route 33 and Route 611. And that hopefully will wrap up by the end of this week. If not, they'll come back after Memorial Day and finish that work up. That's been a long-awaited paving job. We'll be doing quite a bit of paving up in the Mount Pocono area on 611 up in that area. I know that's not your district, but it's a
heavily
traveled area. Yeah. Some of your, I'm sure, constituents
Absolutely.
Go up that way to get to Toby Hanna or other places. So that's going to be taking place. There's going to be a lot of maintenance work going on as a result of the harsh winter. You're going to see a lot of patching work, a lot of what we call base repair type work. That's usually done at the center of the roadway where the two paving lanes meet in. Mm-hmm. There's a joint there that you don't see when you're driving, but there really is where the paving meets for the two different lanes that they pave meets, or the edge of the roadway, maybe breaking apart. They'll fix that and maybe do like a few inches into the travel lane just to shore up that road. Mm-hmm. You'll see our county maintenance folks will be doing oil and chip work on some of the lesser traveled roads, the ones that have lower average daily traffic volumes. Oil and chip, we hear a lot of, once we first do it, a lot of negative response from it, people complaining about the dust, about the chips being kicked up. So when you do see an oil and chip job for the first, say, 3 or 4 days after it's done, you just go much slower than you normally do. Everything should be fine. Once everything gets settled, and it's pretty much just a regular roadway. It does ride a little bit rougher than a blacktop roadway, but it also provides better, a little more friction that
traction
gives you better traction as well. So
right, on wet roads.
Yeah, so if it's rainy or icy, you might get a little bit of traction out of that.
Right. So you're doing a little bit of that for on a cost savings end as far as going rather than paving.
Yeah, most of the paving we do is contracted out, and this year, because of the prior funding scenarios, this fiscal year, which ends June 30th, we don't have as much money to do paving. Now, you'll see in the next 3 to 5 years, because of the new funding revenue sources, you're going to see a lot more paving occurring everywhere.
Right.
You probably won't see a state road that needs paving not being paved over the next 3 to 5 years.
So that's good. So it'll be over a period of time. And I think some people may be expecting everything to be done on the first year or maybe the year and a half, which, you know, a lot of things are happening, but not necessarily.
It's true, and we do still need to get these bridges done, too. And also, you mentioned Interstate 80. We're going to move forward with the design work is moving into preliminary engineering on widening Route 80 from 4 lanes or 2 lanes in each direction to 6 lanes in each, or 3 lanes in each direction between exits 302 and 307. That, when that's done, you know, it's going to be maybe a decade down the road, but when that's done, that's going to be a huge improvement for not just safety on Interstate 80, but also relieving congestion, upgrading all the interchanges in that area to provide longer acceleration and deceleration lanes for traffic entering and exiting the highway, and also providing that extra lane for not just for capacity, but for trucks if they're moving a little slower to use that third lane and let other four-wheel vehicles that can go a little faster, get by them.
And that project in itself is still being reviewed, and I think there's still more public comment times coming for that. Or is there, we've done a couple already.
Yeah, we had two public meetings already, right. Earlier this year. We got a lot of input related to that. Most of it is positive. Yeah. The little bit of negative impact, negative feedback we've been getting is basically from property owners in the area who are worried about their properties. And we understand that is a concern. And there will be quite a bit of property
that makes it very
right
difficult
away that
no
needs
matter
to be acquired.
What project.
Yeah, right now we haven't identified the alignment or anything. But that's what they're working through now. So, yeah, they will be coming back once they narrow down the alignment. They'll come back for more public input. But at that point, the alignment will pretty much be said. At that point, it'll just be working through other issues and getting input as to, maybe where the ramp went, where this will go. Also, all the bridges in that stretch will be brought up to current standard, raised. There's quite a number of oversized vehicles that have to get off the exits and maneuver around, sometimes through the borough of East Stroudsburg and Stroudsburg, and that's not ideal to have them making turns in downtown areas with large
weight limits and
large vehicles. Yeah. Sometimes the boroughs have to raise their traffic signals temporarily and let these units go through. So it's a safety issue. Sometimes the operators of the vehicles don't get their permit or follow a permitted route for an oversized vehicle, and they just think they can come through, and they misjudge it, and they hit the bridge. We've had that occur.
I know that's happened more, actually, than most people would imagine, right?
Yeah, and that's a safety issue as well, because then not only are you jamming up the roadway for traffic, but also then we have to have our inspection teams go out and inspect the bridge. Sometimes the damage is, thankfully, up here really has happened, but we've Interstate 78 down to Berks County, a few times we had bridges get hit where we had to remove the beams because they were hit by an oversized vehicle. So it's a number of things. Shoulders, when that gets widened, it'll update, provide inside shoulders and outside shoulders that will be wide enough for someone breaks down, they can safely get over there, change a tire, do whatever.
Which right now is so difficult,
it's
so
narrow,
dangerous.
And there's no interior shoulders, shoulders basically in that area, and the exterior, the right lane shoulders are pretty narrow in places. So yeah, it's going to be a significant safety improvement along the corridor, and will be a growing pains as they go through the construction.
And that's really, I think, initially what this is all about is a true safety measure, and then probably enhancement in traffic and all of that second. But there's a combo of the two of them together. After all the accidents we've had on 80, and people just, staying away from 80 because of the fact of that it's just such a dangerous roadway with like you said, the little bit, there's no give on any sort, and on the ramps as well. So,
and with the third lane and the shoulders too, will provide, hopefully, is if there is an incident on 80, it'll provide that area where emergency vehicles can get to the scene of the incident, and or use that shoulder area as if necessary to get traffic around it without having to, right now you have an incident on 80, pretty much it's shut down.
Well, boy, 15 minutes goes fast. It went fast when we were talking about Pike County as well. But Ron, at least it gives a little bit of an update for people. And if they have any questions, if there's anything else that maybe hasn't been answered, or if there's a problem with potholes or a safety of a road, always feel free to contact my office as well as PennDOT. And Ron, thank you very much for being here today.
You're welcome.
I appreciate it again. Thank you for watching the Legislative Report. I'm State Representative Rosemary Brown. If you have any questions regarding this show or any other state-related matters, please feel free to contact my office. Thank you.